Testing.
Testing 1, 2. Good morning, good morning, good morning. Welcome to Embrace Hope International. We're at 5613 Rockfish Road in the greater town of Hope Mills. It's good to be here in the house of the Lord once again. Saints, we made it, and we made it through the hard times. We made it through whatever was coming against us this past week. We made it, we made it, we made it. And so we give God the glory. We give him the praise because he got us through that situation. So here we are this morning. We're not ashamed to give God the praise. We're not ashamed to say thank you, Jesus. We're not ashamed to raise our hands and acknowledge and admonish our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. What an awesome God we serve. What a true and living God we serve. It's just a great hour. It's just a great time. So come on in, relax, and just let the word just mesmerize you. Let the word just touch your heart and begin to circumcise you. Whatever is in you that should not be in this atmosphere today, I want you to begin to proclaim, I am free of it. The devil is a liar. I repent of whatever it may be, and begin to proclaim that you are free of it. And the power of the Lord will begin to resonate in your mind. The power of the Lord will begin to resonate in your thought. He says, think on these things. And so God began to tell us some things that we should be thinking upon and thinking on. So allow him to work for you. Allow him to move for you. This is an atmosphere of deliverance. This is an atmosphere of acknowledgement. This is an atmosphere of wisdom. But most of all, it's an atmosphere of release. Just releasing what tried to hold you down. Release what tried to accumulate you in a setting, in a situation that you was not approving of. So today, we rebuke everything that Satan tried to do to you. Today, we rebuke anything that Satan tried to send towards you. And today, we rebuke the people that Satan used to come against our situation. In the mighty name of Jesus. So we give him praise, honor, and glory this morning. So I ask you right now to go with me in prayer. Heavenly Father, I thank you for what you're about to do in this atmosphere. I thank you, Heavenly Father, that you are true and living God. I thank you for what you're going to do in our lives and how you're moving us, orchestrating us, God, and begin to place us in the places that you would desire us to be. So I give you the praise, the honor, and the glory, God. Come into this atmosphere and create into us a clean heart. Renew a right spirit within us in the mighty name of Jesus. So thank you now, God, as we begin to move along this day. The wording of the songs that's going to come is going to help us. The word that's planted in the hearts today is going to come. So thank you, God, that let nothing or no one come into this atmosphere that's going to hinder your word. So, God, we're going to move today in decency and in order. And please, God, thank you. Please, God, bless us. And please, God, help us through this season. In Jesus' mighty name we pray. Amen, amen, amen. Elder Beatty, you ready to come up and mesmerize us through psalms and hymns as the Lord has proclaimed in our hearing his words. His words. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen, 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 and amen.
Thank you, Lord. Hallelujah, for this is the day that the Lord has made. I will rejoice and be glad in it. Hallelujah. We just thank the Lord for a brand new Sunday, a brand new day that God has allowed us to be here, to live, to breathe, to move, to have our being. We just thank God because he's been so wonderful and so merciful. And we just ask on today, Father, that you would go before us, God. Lead and have your way, God. Let your will be done in our lives, Lord. Let us sing songs of Zion that would be pleasing in your sight, Father. We just thank you, Lord, for all your grace and all your mercy, God. Lord, for being so wonderful, so amazing, God, for meeting every need, God. We just thank you, Lord. We give you thanks, honor, and praise in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. So as we seek him out on today, hallelujah, let's just praise him together.
See?
Jesus, seek him out. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord, for he's waiting for you. Hallelujah. Thank you, God. Thank you, God. Seek him in the morning, in the noonday, at midnight. Seek Jesus. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord, that you're always waiting for us to come on in and sup with you. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Father. Thank you, Lord. Just have your way, God. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Father. Thank you, Lord.
We've come a long way.
Grace and his mercy towards my life. Thank you, Lord, for bringing us a long ways. Hallelujah. Thank you, God. Thank you, God. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Father.
This morning, God, he on my
for giving me legs to walk, and you keep on blessing.
You keep on blessing me over and over again.
You keep on blessing.
You keep on blessing me over and over again.
You keep on blessing.
You keep on blessing me over and over again.
You keep on blessing.
You keep on blessing me over and.
God, hallelujah, thank you, God, that you keep on blessing me, hallelujah, thank you, Lord, thank you, Father, hallelujah, thank you, Lord, hallelujah, Lord, thank you, Jesus, hallelujah, Lord, hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. Lord, we thank you. Lord, we thank you. Lord, we thank you.
Lord, we praise you. Lord, we praise you.
You're so worthy, Lord.
Lord, we praise you. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. He's worthy of praise. Hallelujah. Thank you, God. He's so worthy of praise. Hallelujah. Give him a praise, saints. Hallelujah. Thank you, God. Thank you, God, that you spared us another day. Hallelujah. Thank you, God. We give you glory. We give you honor, God. You deserve it, God. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Father. Thank you, Lord. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Father. Thank you, Father. Hallelujah, Lord. Hallelujah, Lord. Thank you, God. Thank you, God. Thank you, Lord. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. Truly, the Lord has been so good, so wonderful, so amazing. Hallelujah. I just tell God thank you for so many times he's carried me up and down the dangerous highways, for so many times how he's healed my body. I just say thank you, Lord, because I know it was nobody but the Lord. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord.
Nobody but you, Lord. Nobody but you. Nobody but you, Lord. Nobody but you. When I was in trouble, you brought me over. Nobody.
Lord,
nobody but you.
When I was sick, Lord,
nobody but you.
When I was in trouble, depending on
nobody but you.
I'm leaning and depending on
nobody but you.
When I was in trouble,
nobody, no one deserved that credit but Jesus, our Lord and Savior Christ. What an awesome day it is to be in the house of the Lord once again. Ah, yes, it's an awesome day to be here again. The weather has permitted, and the Lord is allowing us to come together once again. Praise the name of Jesus. It is good to be in the house of the Lord. I want you to understand that a lot of people are running away from the church, but they should be running to the church so that they can receive that word, because out there they're trying to figure that thing out on their own. But in here we can come together, hear the word of the Lord, and then let God mesmerize our hearts. And yeah, he'll do it. He'll do it every time. In the mighty name of Jesus. First of all, good morning to each and every one of you, those that's online and those that's here locally and within the house. All we like to do here is just give God the praise. Just thank him. Just let him do what he do. So my brother, it's good to have you in the house this morning. Your wife was here last week and she said you was going to come. You know, there's nothing better than a man of his word. So thank you for being a man of your word. You know, some people are losing out on that thing today. You know, they'll tell you they'll be somewhere, and you look for them 2 weeks later, they still got a reason and excuse why they didn't make it. But when you give your word and you show up on your word, that's a lot. You know, there's power. There's power in you when you have self-control. Self-control is being a man of your word. So thank you. To the brother back in the back, thank you. Thank you. Thank you for being here today. This is a house that we just love the Lord, the Lord. Listen, today we're going to celebrate three different things. First of all, today is Sunday, Youth Sunday, the third Sunday. So the third Sunday, we just like to celebrate our children. We like to celebrate the young folks, and we like to celebrate those as young in mind. And so we give God a praise for that. It's also Happy Father's Day to all my fathers listening to me. God bless you to be an awesome father, a man of God. So thank you, thank you, thank you to all the fathers. And then last but not least, Sister Tamara put a word out this morning that says, let's celebrate Juneteenth by coming in our African apparel. So some of our ladies got the message and others didn't. That's all right, but you made it here. And so that's why we are dressed in our African apparel, and Juneteenth we are celebrating, because that thing means so much to each and every one of us. So we give God the praise for that. And so today, I just want to come to you with the power of God. Let him resonate in your heart. Let him strengthen you. And let him do the things that I know he'll do is to deliver you. So turn in your Bibles, if you would. Let's go to 1 Timothy. Let's go to 1 Timothy. And let's go to the fourth chapter of the book of 1 Timothy. And if I had to give you a title for today, to represent today, it would be Perseverance and Responsibility. Perseverance in responsibility. There's a power in your responsibility. I know today should be a day that I would bring forth a word that would honor our Father's Day, but I have to honor what God said to do. And I know, traditionally you should preach the Easter sermon, you should preach the Mother's Day sermon, and you should preach that Christmas sermon. But I believe that I need to preach what he tell me to preach and not be so synchronized in what the world want me to preach. Hallelujah. I know that's not going to go well to some folk, but I just want you to know that you have a man of God that's too afraid to do anything else other than what God has told him to do. So thank God for that. In the mighty name of Jesus. Turn in your Bibles to 1 Timothy and go to the fourth chapter of the book of 1 Timothy as we begin to talk about perseverance in responsibility. Father, I come to you now. I thank you for who you are, for what you're about to do in this house. God, use me, Father. I decrease now as you begin to increase in your power, and let your will be done, Father, like never before. You are an awesome God. You are a powerful God. Strength beyond measure lies within you. And because of it, God, we are pulling on you this morning to allow that strength to come into us. In the mighty name of Jesus, you said the things that Jesus done, so shall we do. And so I'm standing on that word this morning, God, that whatever Jesus done in this atmosphere, your word shall resonate in our hearts, in our minds, in our souls this morning, that we're able to receive the fullness of you, that we will be able to say amen, which means I agree. So thank you now, God, for what you're doing in his atmosphere. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. We're in the book of 1 Timothy. Go to the fourth chapter of the book of 1 Timothy. I want to start with this particular scripture and wording just in case I don't get back to it. Father's Day in the book of Malachi in chapter 4, Father's Day tells us that the prophet of the coming of Elijah, he says, behold, I will send you Elisha the prophet before the coming of the great and dreadful day of the Lord. And he will turn the hearts of the fathers to the children and the hearts of the children to the fathers, lest I come and strike the earth with a curse. So God is saying that I'm going to come now, and I want to change the hearts of the children to move towards the Father. And I want to change the hearts of the Father to move towards the children. Why? Because there's so many families that's destroyed, totally destroyed, because dad didn't line up. He didn't line up. He came up with reasons why he didn't have to be there, and avenues why he had to run away. But for those that stayed, and those that said, you know, it's hard, but I'm still going to stay. These are my children. This is my wife, and I'm going to stay. And because of that, God says, I'm going to bless you. He says that a good man shall save an inheritance for his children's children. So God is looking at us, fathers, to be the man of God that he wants us to be. And in so doing, he says, I'll strengthen you. He says, I'll bless your finance. You will prosper in me because you're doing my word. And so if you're a young man, you're not yet a father, just know that, as I was saying to the gentleman early, when you say something, you do it. When you say you're going to be there, and when you make a promise, fulfill that promise, unless something comes against you where you fully can't, and then it's a matter of you responding to whomever you said you was going to be there, I'm just not going to make it. Why? Because there is a perseverance and responsibility. Responsibility simply means to respond based on your ability. It's to respond based on your ability. And if you are responding based on your ability, responsibility, then this simply means that you're persevering to be a person that God can use. You're persevering that a person that God can use because you are responding to your ability. Some of us don't respond to our ability, but we fall prey to fatigue. And fatigue is coming to take you off of your game. Fatigue is coming to bring along its cousins. His cousin is oppression and depression and dissension. His brothers and his sister, they come to pull you out of a direction and to move you in a direction that's not of God. So that's why God sent me here today to say, I want you to persevere in your response to your ability. Oh, y'all got to hear me today. We're going to move somewhere today. I promise you. Because here in 1 Timothy, God was using Paul as he began to talk to the people. He began to talk to that young fellow called Timothy. Timothy was a young man when he started his ministry. And not only was he young, but he was in an area where it was a highly metropolitan type place where people was fully coming and going. He was at the Church of Ephesus in the Asia Minor area. And in the Asia Minor area, it was more of a trade center, commercial trade center. And the people was coming and going, trading. They'd come off the sea, and they'll come in, buy, sell, do what they do, and they'll go back. Some would actually stay. But in the midst of their going and coming, they decided that they'll serve a different God than our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. God has sent me here, and he told the writers, he says, tell 1 Timothy to combat false teaching with sound doctrine. Combat false teaching with sound doctrine. Because in this particular area, people was coming to hear whatever their itching ears would hear based on whatever was preached there, because they needed somewhere that they can go and say amen, but it was not to our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. As they began to move through this area, this was a place that was built up similar to that of New York City. And they was going and coming. People were doing all type of things. But he told Timothy, he says, Timothy, I need for you to encourage Christian conduct. I want you to go in and encourage Christian conduct. But mind you now, Timothy was a young man. He was a very young man that had been called to be a minister, called to be someone's pastor. I want you to fully understand, as the writer began to tell him, Paul began to tell him, he says, hey, I need for you to realize that there's some things going on in this city. There's some things going on in the people of God. There's some things going on in the hearts of God that our true and savior God, he's not pleased with. He's not happy with. So I need for you to go in and begin to talk to these people. Young people, I want to start with you because I want you to fully understand, if you are responding and persevering in your abilities, God is yet ready to bless you. He's ready to give you your heart desire. And those of you that's young in heart, doesn't matter your age, if you're still young in heart, then you are who I'm talking to today. Why? Because God wants to truly bless you. God wants to strengthen you. God wants to give you your heart desire. But there has to be a perseverance in you. There has to be a drive in you. There has to be a tenaciousness about you, because you you want the world to see I can't give up right here. You want your family to see I can't quit right here. And you want your drive to be, if I fail right here, that's not the end of my story. This is not the end of my chapter. I have more to write in my book of life. And when you begin to do that, you begin to move away from the people that's pulling you, moving away from the people that has not your best interest in mind. You begin to move away from the people, and they're going to talk about you, say some things about you, try to, you know, come at you from all different angles, because they still want you in that same mind of dispensation that you used to be, so that you can kind of buddy up with them, because they're happy, because misery love company. But because you are positive, because you got your mind together, and because you say, you know what, I can't do this no more, just don't feel right for me to be here no more, you begin to distance yourself from the crowd. When you begin to do that, God says there's maturity that's setting into you. There's some things about you that's changing. There's changing. So Paul began to tell Timothy, you are a young man and you are introduced to opportunities, some situations that's going to take you out. They come to take you out. They come to move you in a direction that's not of God. I don't want you to get materialized, because remember now, in this commercial area, great God, people was coming with everything. Anything that you could actually want, they was bringing it. And because Timothy was in an environment that he was a young man, but people was bringing him things, he was too easy to get pulled towards things and move away from the power of God. How many of us, you don't have to raise your hand, I got mine up, you don't have to raise your hand, but how many of us have been moved towards things and then the power of God? Got your house, you don't want nobody in it. You got your brand new car, don't want nobody ride in it. Praise the name of Jesus. Don't want them riding. I just got this car, man. You can't know. You better not eat nothing up in here. What's wrong with you? My goodness, God blessed me with this car. Now that car becomes your little G God. What God has given you, he said, I can take it away from you. Get to your house, and while you was in that apartment, you had the doors open, people coming and going. But now the Lord done bless you with a house, you let nobody in. In fact, you done sneaked away to a place where he ain't let nobody know where you go. Why? Because I don't want nobody coming up in my new house. This is my house. And you got white carpet on your floor, and don't want nobody walking there with their dirty shoes. Take them off at the door. In fact, take them off outside the door, because I don't really don't even want you in here. So that's how we begin to, I know I ain't talking about nobody here. I know. I know I ain't talking about nobody. But we begin to move in a direction. See, Timothy was so subject to be pulled with materialistic things that he got to the point where he just didn't want to serve God like we need for him to serve God. And that's why the Bible tells us that Paul told him, don't get caught up in the material things, but encourage Christian conduct. Woo! I said, okay, Lord, I'm with you. So watch this part. We're in the book of 1 Timothy. We're in chapter 4, but look at verse 11. Paul began to talk to Timothy. He says, these things command Timothy, and these things I want you to teach. Not only do I want you to command them, but I need for you to teach them. See, there's a difference in command and teach. Command simply means that if you command something, you desire it to happen right then, and you desire that thought process to have some longevity to it. So if you command something, you say, whatever I command, it has to have longevity to it. It's going to happen over a long period of time. But if you teach something, then it's in the hearts and the minds of the people, and when it's taught, they won't forget about it. Command only goes for a series of time or a season of time. But when you teach a person how to do it, when you teach a person how to say and move the right way, there's a difference. So not only did he say command them, but I want you to teach them. So if you're coupling the two together, command and teach, when that particular command begin to reach its course, teaching will bring it back. Y'all with me? When commands simply begin to reach its course, what you have taught him will bring it back in line. So command them and teach them. But then he says, let no one despise your youth. In other words, Timothy, let no one come against you because you're a young man. young people, let no one come against you today. They came against you yesterday, but going forward, no one is going to come against you and cause you to feel like what they are saying about you is who you really are. No more. We allow people to call themselves speaking into your life and they're speaking condemnation in your life and you're saying, yes, sir, amen, thank you, Jesus. No, no, that's not how God moved. God says, I will bless you. So let no one despise your youth, but an example to the believers in the word, believe them to an example of the believers in the word. So let's break this thing down because I want you to fully understand. I want you to see here in 1 Timothy chapter 4 and verse 2. He says, let no one despise your youth, but be an example to the believers in word. To be an example in the believers in word. The word of God is the will of God. The will of God is the power of God. Say that again, Pastor. He says, I want you to command and teach them, but be an example to the believers in what? In word. So the word of God is the will of God, and the will of God is the power of God. So when you're operating through the power, Ephesians 3 and 20 tells us, now to him that is able to do exceedingly and abundantly and above all that you may ask or think, according to what? The power of that word already working inside of you. So there's a power in you already. There's a word in you already. There's a gift in you already that God is ready for you to operate under. He's ready for you to move towards it, and he's ready for you to embrace the power that God has already placed inside of you. So he says, I want you now to encourage them and command them in the word of God. Oh, yeah, y'all see that in your Bibles? Yeah, in the word of God. Then he says, not only do I want you to talk to them about the word of God, but I want you to talk to them about their conduct. Conduct is your focus on what you believe in and conduct yourself accordingly. He says, I want you to command and teach them in their conduct. You know, a lot of times our music will allow you to conduct yourself a certain kind of way. Say it again, Pastor. Our music would move you in a direction to conduct yourself in a way that's not of God. And so, because he says teach and command their conduct, we have to fully understand that in your conduct, anxiety will always rear its head, because anxiety wants you to be angry all the time, frustrated all the time, mad all the time. How come I don't have this? How come God won't bless me with that? How come God won't move? Hey, blessing everybody else, but how come? It's just anxiety is in there. But he says, Timothy, I want you to teach them about their conduct, because your conduct is what's going to bring you through. Your conduct has power with it. Your conduct will open up your heart, open up the floodgates to you. Your conduct, you angry about something, but you wasn't moved by it. I want you to fully understand, you have power. You have controlling power. When you can control your conduct of yourself, when you can control your mindset of yourself, when you are in control, you're operating on the power. You're operating on the power. So he says, tell them to learn about conduct. Thank you, God, about this conduct. But then he says, I want you to command and teach them about love. Love is good. Love is kind. Love is not envy. Love is not boastful. Okay, we know all of that. We know about that. But what about loving your brothers and loving your sisters and loving your significant other? What about loving them like they should be loved? Oftentimes when you've been around a person long enough, you fall out of love with them, and then you're just putting up with them. And while you're putting up with them, things is just not flowing like it should be flowing. Why? Because you're not operating in love. But God is simply telling us, operate in love, because love conquers everything. God says, I so loved the world that I gave you my only begotten son. So because he loves us, he sent Jesus down here to last for a season, and then he took him back because he wants us to see this is the example of love, but this is the power that I still have is to pull him back away from you. So God says, I love you, but you cannot operate out of love and expect to get anything from me. So he says, command love, but I want you now to command them to stay in the spirit world. You see, the Bible tells us in John 6 and 63, everything about the flesh is going to die, but everything about the spirit is going to live forever. So he said, I want you to command them, and I want you to teach them how to operate in the spirit. See, because when you're on that job and somebody come at you a way that you don't want them to come at you, or keep calling your phone and keep texting you about craziness, and you tired of dealing with them, he said, I want you to move in spirit. So your spirit will cause you to go to God so he can fix it, but your mind will tell you, man, put your hands on them, go ahead on and jack them up and pick them up and let them know you tired of them and what they keep saying about you. Before you know it, you got your hand around their neck and you're squeezing the life out of them. Didn't I tell you leave me alone and you won't leave me alone? And so your flesh will cause you to move in a direction that now you got to get a lawyer. You in the courthouse, and then them boys in blue gonna come and shackle you down, and then first thing they gonna do is have you on the news, everybody knowing what you've done, and they see how you is. Well, dear, I thought brother so-and-so was more controlled than that. I thought sister so-and-so was more controlled than that. But because you was not moving in the spirit, and because you allow your anxiety and you allow the frustration that was in your heart to control you, you're now moving in a direction that's not of God. You see, to live in the spirit just simply means I must obey God. Because I don't care who you are, how rich you are, what side of the track you grew up on. Some point in your life, you're going to get mad about something. Some point in your life, you're going to become angry about something. Some point in your life, you're going to be frustrated and tired of it. But God says if you move in love and you move in the spirit world, then he knows that when you get there, that's why he says be angry but sin not. Why? Because he knows you're going to get angry. Let's make this thing clear. Jesus Christ became angry. He became so angry, the boy was kicking over chairs. He was grabbing people and throwing them out the church. You can say what you want to say, but Jesus was fighting on that day. He was fighting on that day because he let nothing or nobody come against the word of God. Nothing or nobody come against the word of God. And this is how you and I need to be. When somebody is trying to pull you in a direction that's not of God, we need to fight back with the word of God. Jesus came in that place and said, oh, you're not going to make my house a den of thieves. You're just not going to do that. And so he began to grab the tables and turn them over. He began to grab people and throw them out of there. He began to move people in a direction that was not of him. Get them out of my sight. Why? Jesus was fighting on that day. Now, they didn't say that he picked nobody up and beat them up. He didn't have to. He just looked at them and they began to levitate all over the world and levitate all in the air. He had to put his hands on. He had to go to get his posse. He had to go get his gat and put a round of clips in and come back with his vest on and spray in the air. Jesus didn't have to do that. He just command respect. This is what I'm trying to get you to understand this morning. You have to command respect. When people are in your face and they're saying all kind of things that they should not be coming out of your mouth, nothing should make you stand there and listen to that. You have to command respect. So I got this brother that I go see, and he could be listening, but that's all right. I go see him, and he get a little oil in him, and then everything come out of his mouth is like his daddy, profanity and everything else coming out of his mouth. And so, hey, brother, as long as you're talking like that, you're talking to the wind. Cause I can't stand here and let you say all that stuff to me. And I say, okay, yeah, man, I understand what you know. I don't understand it because I no longer believe in that type of language. So I can't subject myself to that type of language. Why? Because that type of language is not of God, but it's of Satan. So if I'm standing here listening and nodding my head and he drinking and study coming at me with all this profanity, no, I can't stay there because he's my brother, natural brother. Then, you know, I can't stay there because Jesus called us to a higher standard that the people that's talking to you, they have to admonish who you are. They have to know that you're a Christian person. That's why he says command them and teach them. That's just not for you, but it's against the people that's coming towards you. Why? Because if you're a Christian, you can't stand and listen to that rhetoric language of Satan. You can begin to talk to them. You know what? The Bible tells me that, you know, you shouldn't use profane language and babbling and that type of thing. The Bible tells me that we shouldn't talk like that. Okay, well, you can't tell me what to say. You can't tell me what to do. But I want you to fully understand this and watch me. Watch me. Watch this. Watch this. When someone is in your face and they're talking this profanity, and they're filled with alcohol and they're doing this, this is what they think they should do. But now you turn the tables and you're talking about your Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. This is what the Bible tells us to do. They don't want to hear that, but they want you to hear what they're saying. No, we got to make a strong decision. I can't listen to that. So when Sister So-and-so call you when you were leaving the parking lot of the church and she begin to talk about what Brother So-and-so had and what brothers, don't stop them in the tracks. I don't do gossip. We're not going to do that right now. I know I'm not talking nobody. I know I'm just talking. But we don't do gossip. So don't talk to me about Brother So-and-so. You should have went over and told Brother So-and-so that he had on jacked up pants. You shouldn't have to come to me and tell me what Brother So-and-so. I didn't even pay him no attention because I was too wrapped up in hearing the word of God. But Sister So-and-so did this. And Sister So-and-so, I don't want to hear it. Did you pray for Sister So-and-so? Did you go up to her and say, you know, the Lord told me to tell you this because you were saying this and you was going through that. Did you try to fix it right then? Or you were gathering information? You know, some of us have a recorder in our mind. They can remember word and word verbatim of a conversation. And then they can't wait to get to somewhere so they can call somebody and begin to talk about what Sister So-and-so. Girl, I heard she said this. A man, he said that. What he do? Man, he trying to tell this. No, we shouldn't be listening to that rhetoric, but we got to move in the spirit, and our conduct must be, if they come to us with that, they're going to straighten up. Have you ever been in a conversation where someone begin to curse and they be like, oh, I'm sorry, I'm going to straighten myself up. I'm sorry, I know you're a Christian. I'm not going to talk about that right now. That's how God wants your spirit. Oh, I know I'm not talking about it here, but that's how God wants your spirit, that people will recognize the God in you and they will feel bad about how they're talking to you and they will feel bad about how they're coming at you. But there is a perseverance in your responsibility, because when you respond to your abilities, people will begin to see that you're running behind God. Say it again, Pastor. When you begin to persevere behind your responsibility, you're going to move based on your responsibility. So you're going to respond based on the ability that God has given you. So now you're persevering against that response that's coming against you to your abilities of God. God will bless you. God will strengthen you. God will help you. And God will help you to professionally let these people know, I can't hear that. I can't do that. Young people, I want you to fully understand that this world is so bombarded with everything to try to pull you from the house of God. It doesn't want you to come to church. It wants you to hang out on Saturday night. It wants you to get to the club with them. It wants you to do all the things that you thought was pleasurable, but they don't want to come to church. Okay, if I go to the club with you tonight, will you come with me in the morning? In the morning to get here, and they got all kind of reasons why they can't make it. No, we shouldn't get ourselves involved in that. So Paul began to talk to Timothy. Timothy, command these things and teach them. Then not only do I want you to teach them in spirit, but teach them about faith. Faith is the substance of things hoped for, the evidence of things not seen. You see, when we begin to fall out of place with faith, Jesus said, it's impossible to please me. It's impossible to please me. Uh-oh. It's impossible to please God if I don't believe that he's God. Or it's impossible to believe in God if I'm relying upon the strength of the situation or the circumstance to pull me in a direction that I am now responding to? No, that's not of God. God says, don't move hastily. Oh, I know she has some urgency. She call you, say the light bill was due on Thursday. It's Wednesday night, and it's about 9 o'clock Wednesday night, and she can pull it on you all this week. Talking about she need $100 out of your pocket to pay that light bill that she knew she had last month. But right now, you are the one that she going to pull on right now, because she knows if she done drank up and smoke up and did everything she did last month with that $100, she know you're going to bail her out. So here you go now, Lord, should I help her? Lord, what to do about this situation? God told you last month to leave her alone. God told you last month don't pay nothing. God told you stay away from that situation. Why? Because if you're going to make me cut your finances off, I will, so that you won't do it. Because, see, God will begin to chastise people. God wants you to bring your tithes away. I ain't bringing no tithes. The pastor going to live bad to me. I ain't bringing no tithes. Well, don't bring them then. You miss your blessing on your own. That's you, but I'm going to bring my tithe. But anyhow, it's the 11th hour. It's the study calling you. If you don't get it to me now, they're going to turn my lights off. Sometimes I keep telling them to turn it off, Lord. Help me to get to Walmart and get some candles. And then we begin to flow from there. Because people will consistently use you, they consistently come at you, and they consistently move you in a direction that's not of God. And so God will begin to tell us, don't do that, stay away from that, but I want you to move in faith, and now watch this, move in purity, open-minded to Jesus. Because when you begin to move with purity and you're moving in faith, you'll tell that sister, my sister, look, if you just pay your tithes off of that check that you get, God will open up the windows of heaven and pour you out blessings. You won't have enough room enough to receive. But I ain't paying no tithes. But if you pay your tithes, you obligate God to help you. Well, I ain't paying no tithes because I can't afford to pay my tithes. But you look in the kitchen, she got everything. If you look in her living room, she got everything. If you look out there, she got a nice car. She can afford all of that, but she can't afford tithes. Pastor, leave that alone. Okay, yeah, I will. Leave that alone, Pastor. She got everything she needs, but she can't pay that $100 light bill. God will bless you when you move in faith. God will bless you when you move in purity. Purity of heart. God, I don't have what I need, but I know if I keep my heart on you, I know if I keep my faith in you, you will bless me. I know you're going to move for me. I know you're going to help me out. Why? Because you did it before. And if you did it before, I know you'll do it again. And you'll do it again and do it again. So now what's happening is if your faith is strong in God and the purity of your heart is directed towards God, God says, I take pleasure in the prosperities of my children. God will begin to open up financial doors. He begin to send people to you that will bless you. They give it to out of their excess. Why? Because they have an accumulation, because they've been mindful of the things of God. And God says, now you have an excess. Go and shake hands. And don't let the left hand know what the right hand is doing, because you're not going to get a reward if you do what I told you to do. But move like I said move. Shake their hand and give them that $100. Don't worry about it, because you know if you give them that $100, like I said, I'm going to magnify that thing 100-fold. And let me help you understand this. Neither one of us in here can be God-given. Can't do it. Can't do it. I don't care how many billions you got in the bank. You can't be God-given. Because you may be able to give them that million or that billion, but you can't give them that peace of God that goes beyond measure. So he says, not only do I want you to talk to them about faith and purity, young people, I want you to know that the music that I was talking to you about earlier is got to the point where the women are now becoming rap artists. And I like to attack rap music. I like to attack all this demonology music and all of that stuff. But I want you to fully understand, the women now are so explicit in their rapping game that they're trying to outdo the men. And men is trying to outdo the women. But nevertheless, young folk, you should not be listening to that stuff, because that's not of God and it should not be of you. But they just rapping, it's just music. The devil is a liar. It's a wording that's going out that's combining your mind. The Bible tells us in Philippians, he says, think on these things. Whatever is pure, whatever is noble, whatever is kind, whatever is a good report, think upon these things. And if you do, and if you meditate on these things, God says you'll be established in all of your doings and all of your going. Sometimes back in the day, saints, I don't know about you, but I'm talking about Julius Davis. I could listen to rap music and that thing would have me where I want to run through the world. I want to fight everybody. I had some mindsets about me that just wasn't good after I listened to rap music. So I had to get myself together and move towards jazz. And that way, I'm just listening to the instruments and everything is good. But you begin to talk to me about rap music, I got so inundated in that thing, and I got so intertwined in that thing. Man, I'm listening to Shorty the Pimp. Y'all don't know about no Too Short. Too Short was strong. Too Short was bringing that thing in there. Who that? EPMD. They begin to sing this song, and they begin to talk that mess. Oh, man, don't let the Thugs of Harmony, don't let NWA begin to get into that thing. Oh, my chest big. Now I'm ready. And I got that Miller on the side. I don't really care about Miller, but at the time it was good. And then I like Michelob, you know, that Miller Lite. And I got a Miller Lite in my hand surrounded by that Michelob. And boy, I can't leave out that crown. Something about that Crown Royal. Ooh-wee. That Crown Royal get your mind right. And so now I got that Crown Royal over here. I got that Miller Lite or that Michelob right there. And I got that rap music right there. You can't stand in my way because I feel like now I could tear through a brick wall. Why? Because my mind was jacked up on what people was trying to get me to do. And as long as I felt like that, as long as I was in that conduct, as long as I was operating in that mindset, as long as I was doing the things I was doing, the Bible tells us the world loves you because you're part of it. But when I pull you out of the world is going to be angry at you because you walked away from the world. I'm trying to encourage you young folks this morning, walk away from the things of this world and begin to move to the power of God. Because now what used to be too short to me, the rapper Too Short, and I ain't picking on Too Short. He is short, but I ain't picking on him. But the, whatever it is, now your cell phone is that addiction. And you can be on that cell phone for hours going through Instagram, and now they got TikTok doing the things that they do. They ain't got no business doing, but they on there and begin to look at it. You be like, And if you're not careful, TikTok, Instagram will raise your children. And they will have your child acting in a way that you can't understand. Why you acting like that? Because Satan began to use that cell phone to pull them in a direction that's not in the conduct of God. Now they're saying things out their way, and they begin to come at you. And so I was talking to a young person the other day. He's like, nah, man, no clap, man, no clap, man, no clap. I'm like, what are you talking about, sir? No cap, man. No cap, you know. No cap, man. I said, no cap. What are you talking about? Well, I didn't know because, you know, I ain't in the world. No cap just simply means no lie. I didn't know that. But the cap means no lie. So, you know what, man? You feel me, dog? You feel me, man? No cap to you. You feel me? No, man. I ain't feeling on you. What you talking about? What are you talking about, man? I ain't feeling on you. What you talking about? No, no cap, man. No cap. So he telling me, do I understand what he's saying? Well, speak English to me, brother. Because I don't speak that Ebonics no more. I don't understand what you're talking about. Okay, man. All right, man. I'm down. I'm down. Okay, we'll see you later, brother. Because where I work at, there's a lot of street people that comes through the house. And they feel like they can shoot me a game and get $2-3 out of me and go about their way. So they come with this all type of language that I have to hear. But I want you to understand that God will quicken your spirit. And not only will it quicken your spirit, it'll give you the discernment of spirit to say, oh, no, man, I can't hear this. I can't do that. And so when you begin to be in tune with God, young folk, when you become in tune with God, something will pop up on your cell phone and you'll stroll through it because, you know, I ain't looking at this no more. And, you know, they said, I mean, I don't know how true this is, but they said if you got an iPhone, they listen to your conversation. And if they're listening to your conversation, maybe 2 days, 3 days later when whoever put it in your computer, what you was talking about, there'll a pop-up will come on your phone. And then you can just go through that and do whatever you want to do. But I don't know how true that is, and I'm not going to put that out. But I want you to fully understand this. Talk about God, let that pop-up come up. Talk about God and how he saved your life, let that pop-up come up. And talk about the resurrection of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, how he brought me through a hard time. Let that pop up, because I want everybody to know I serve a true and living God. He will help me. He will strengthen me. He will give me my heart desire. Let that pop up on my screen. So if you listen to that. That my God will supply all of my needs according to his riches and glory in Christ Jesus. But look at verse 14. This is what I've been trying to get to. Yeah, Lord, I thank you. This is where I've been trying to get to. He says, do not neglect the gift that is in you. Saints, there is so much wealth inside of us. There's so much talent inside of you. There's so many doors opening for you. It's already in you, because he said, don't tell them, Timothy, tell them to do not neglect the gift that is in them, because there's a gift that God has placed in you for the building up of his kingdom. There's a gift that God has placed in you for the building up of his kingdom. You see, that's why this gift that you have, you could be doing it in ease, but somebody else will be struggling trying to do it. Why? Because God has placed that gift in you for the betterment of you, your family, and his church. So he says, do not neglect the gifts that is in you, which was given to you by the prophets with the laying on of the hands of the Presbyterians. The prophets. The laying on of hands. So there's a gift in each and every one of us that God wants you to use. And periodically I would text someone during the day and say, hey, are you standing on the gift that God has blessed you? Well, Pastor, I was thinking about it. You know, I don't really have the finances to do what I need to do. I don't know the wherewithal. I don't have the wisdom. Did God place that in you? Yeah, Pastor, every time I sleep, it's coming against me. Every time I think about something else, here comes that thing coming at me. I feel like God want me to do it, but I just don't know how to do it. Well, let me help you. The first thing he says to do is write it down. Write down the gift. So when you begin to write it down, God says when you begin to write it down, he says the reader will read it and run with it. So now not only do you need to write that thing down, but as you begin to write it down, you go back to it, you're going to begin to set goals. Set obtainable goals, young folks. Set obtainable goals. And when you begin to set that goal, you complete this goal. Now you have a short goal, you have an immediate goal. You have a right now goal, immediate goal, and a long-term goal. So as you begin to move based on your writing and you begin to orchestrate based on your writing, that immediate goal, you can obtain it. It gives you faith. That medium goal, when you obtain that, it have you walking into the prophecy of God. And then when you finally get to where God, the crown of glory, is received by you, now you can look back from whence you came and realize if it had not been for God in my side, there's no way I can do it. So don't worry about whether or not you had the finances. Write it down. Don't worry about if I have the wisdom. Write it down. Don't worry about if I can make this thing happen. Write it down. Remember now, the title of this thing is Persevere Through Your Responsibilities. Persevere, respond, ability. God has given you the ability to be successful that you need to be, but you got to first look at the response. Are you responding to your abilities? Are you allowing someone else to pull it from you? Are you allowing someone else to take it from you? So now you can't respond to your abilities because you're too worried about what somebody else think about you and they've been saying about you and you've been butting up with what they're saying about you. Now your self-esteem is so low that you need to be pulled out of that. But I'm coming to tell you today, the devil is a liar. You are a woman or a man of God. You are powerful. There's a strength inside of you. There's a drive inside of you. And let me help you understand. That's why people keep coming to you to talk about things, because they realize that there's a power in you that gives them great counseling, but you just don't realize it. Counsel yourself. Lay hands on your own self. Command your body to line up with the word of God, because if God has placed that gift in you, he can allow you to use it on you so that you could be successful for God in the things that he has placed inside of you. How many of you walk through the house, lay hands on your own head and command this body to line up, command this body to do the things of God, command this body to move like God would want it to move? How many of you get up early in the morning, according to Psalms, the 5th chapter, get up early in the morning, meditate on God, and throughout your meditation, lay hands on your own head and command that frontal lobe to line up, because that frontal lobe is your communication center, and you command that frontal lobe to line up through the power of God. You will do the will of God. You will do the purpose of God. Because John 6:63 tells us that everything about the flesh is going to die. So this old body is going to leave us. The Bible says you were appointed once to die and once to be judged. He didn't put an age on it. He said you're going to leave here. So when we get ready to leave here, lay hands on your own head and make this flesh line up to the will of God. Line up to the purpose of God. Some of us have aches and pains. Some of us have things coming at you because you will not make the flesh line up with God. Oh, I know I'm talking to myself. But sometimes I just get up in the morning and I walk through the room and I'm laying hands on my own head. You will do this. You will do that, flesh. You are subjected to my thought process. And my thought process has got to be the thought of God. Flesh, you will line up. Because the Bible tells us in John 6:63, everything about the spirit shall live. So as I begin to speak the spirit over my life, as I begin to speak prosperity over my life, God would begin to open up a door. 1 Corinthians 16 and verse 9 says, praise the name of Jesus. He said, I've opened a door for you, a wide door for you, but there are many adversaries. So that adversary is trying to prevent you from going through that door and receiving the things of God. But it don't want you to receive the things of God. So it'll come at you from all angles. Young folks, is coming at you because if I can kill this generation, if I can take this generation from the power of God, if I can take this generation from thinking about the love of God, if I can change this generation, I can get people, I can separate families, I can come against the man, I can come against the woman, and they will have no one to help them. Why? Because they're believing in what this thing is saying. But the devil is a liar. Today we're going to stand on that God is a deliverer. We're going to stand on that God is going to help us. I know that your finances is not lining up like you want it to be, but God says, I will bless you. I will strengthen you. I wish above all that you prosper and be in good health, even as your soul shall prosper. Though your leg could be hurting right now, but touch that leg, says line up with the power of God. Though your heart may be hurting, touch that thing, says line up to the power of God. Touch that hair. You may have headaches. You may have migraines. You can't hardly see out your eyes like you used to. But begin to say, line up to the power of God. I don't know if you're afraid to begin to talk to you. I don't know if you're afraid to lay hands on you. But say, line up to the power of God. We have the power. How do you know I got the power, Pastor? Because the Bible tells us in Luke, the 9th chapter, 1 and 2, that I give you the authority to lay hands on the sick. They shall recover. I give you the power to cast out demonic spirits. What is this that's coming to you? Rebuke it and realize you have the power to get it off of you. My child is sick, Pastor. I don't know what to do. Jesus told you in Luke, the 9th chapter, what to do. He says, lay hands on the sick and they shall recover. So many times, saints, I took God at his word that my children may be sick. I lay hands on them. I pray. I'm believing God's going to bring them through it. So many times my wife might not be 100%, but I lay hands on her and I know that God came through, because I believe if I lay hands on you, it's going to happen. I believe that God is going to bless you. I believe that God is going to give you a heart desire. You know, the Bible tells us if a man on earth, an earthly man, can give good gifts to his son, how much more would the Father in heaven give unto you that ask of him? Watch this, saints. Watch this. I begin to do this even more now. I say after my prayers, I say, Lord, do this thing for me because I ask you to do it. He said if the Father on earth could give good gifts, you ask of him, how much more would the Father do if you ask of him? So I said, Lord, do it because I ask him. And when he do it because I ask him, that raises up your chest, that put more strength in your drive. That said, Lord did it because I asked him to do it. I've been asking God for some things. And see, like every time I ask him, say, Lord, do it because I ask you to do it, he does it. He does it. And I'm walking in a faith that says, if I say it, it's going to come true. If I think it with the power of God, it's going to happen. Why? Because if you stay lined up and connected to God, he'll do it just because you ask him to. So I don't want you to neglect that gift that's in you. Which was given to you by the prophets. Then he says, meditate on these things. Give yourself entirely to them that your progress may be evident to all. Say it again. Pastor, I begin to shout. I say, okay, Lord, I got it. He said, meditate on these things. Give yourself entirely to them. What meditation he talking about, saying? He was talking about that gift that God has placed upon you. Meditate on these things. Give yourself entirely to them that your progress may be evident to all. So when God begin to bless you, when you got your mind together, young folk, and you writing down your vision and you're making it plain and you're running with it and you're trying to do the best you can because you're meditating, God said, I am going to make your way prosperous. He said, your progress may be evident to all. So everybody around you going to see, man, how did he get that? Man, how did she do this? Why? Because you stayed in faith to God. Take heed to yourself. Take heed to yourself. He says, I want you to look at yourself and to the doctrine. Take heed of yourself and to the doctrine. So what doctrine has been taught to you? You know, we get into a time in this season called church that pastors are getting up here with their own agendas. And they getting up here won't tell you what the word says, but they'll tell you what their thought process is because they have a mission in mind and they have a destination in mind that's going to fulfill their desires. So they're going to come up here and say, you know what, the Lord told me to tell you this and the Lord told me to tell you that, but they lied because the Lord didn't tell them nothing. Not about that anyhow. So many are the called, but few chosen. So the Bible says many of them went out to preach, but are they really preaching the word of God? Many have gone out, but there's few chosen to do the work of God. That's why Embrace Hope International, hear me clearly this morning. If I bring someone across this pulpit, I have already thought that they would be a good person, but I don't know who they might see in the congregation that impresses them enough to begin to move in a different direction. And when they're moving to that different direction, Embrace Hope, you hear me now, that you don't run up here and let everybody lay hands on you, because the Bible says lay hands on no man suddenly. And because they got you in the inner part and they feel good about what he just said, and then now it's time to take up the tithes and offer. He felt like if I got you in a good mindset, you're going to give up better tithes, you're going to get up better offer. The devil is a liar. Jesus will tell you, don't move based on what somebody has told you, but move through the power of God. Move through your faith that God will bless me. God will give me my heart desire. Don't be running up here letting everybody lay hands on you. And now I got to get that spirit up out of you because he have injected a poison in you that's going to come against the people in here. Oh, y'all better hear me. Y'all better hear me. I'm out of here them preaching. I bring them in based on what I heard. But I don't know who changes what when. So you got to be careful how you allow people to do that. But he says, meditate on these things. Give yourself entirely to them that your progress may be evident to all. Then he says, take heed to yourself and to the doctrine. Continue in them. Take heed yourself, not Pastor Davis, but take heed to yourself and to the doctrine and continue in the doctrine. For in doing so, you will save both yourself and those who hear you. Oh, y'all see that in your Bibles. He said, take heed to yourself and to the doctrine. Man, I'm about to go tell her something. Shoot, she don't know me. I mean, woo, I'm from up north. I go tell her. But he says, take heed to yourself and to the doctrine. I'm from down south. They don't know how we flow down south. We don't do it like this. Take heed to yourself and continue in them. For in doing this, you will save both yourself and those who hear you. So it doesn't matter where you're from, it's where you're at. Because you can get the bricks beat off of you if you were from Louisiana, the same way you can get the bricks beat off of you if you was in Maine. And see, Satan don't care where you're at, is where you, or he don't care where you're from, is where you are right now. And when he see that you're progressing into the power of God, he say, go get her. Go get him. He's getting too quick. He's moving too much. He's learning too much. Go get him. So young folks, when you begin to read the Bible and the Bible become alive in you, there's a joy in you that you just cannot fathom. There's a joy in you that fentanyl can't bring to you. There's a joy in you that cocaine can't get you high enough. There's a joy in you that alcohol, you know, when you're sneaking and you got that oldest friend to go to the ABC store and he got it and now he gonna tell everybody what they got and y'all go somewhere and pour it in a cup and then you post them on the ground for the brothers is not here and you should be drinking it anyway, your young self, and you're messing up the inside of you and that fermentation is inside of you, but you're doing it anyhow because you want to be part of the in crowd. Well, let me help you with this. The in crowd is going to be the out crowd eventually, and you don't want to be part of the out crowd, but certainly not the out crowd of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. You want to be in the in crowd. So sometimes you just got to shake your head. No, man, come on, man. You with us? No, man, just sip it, man. Just sip a little bit. No, because I can't be around you if this is the way you're trying to take me. Young folks, you got to understand, you got to change your thought process. And when you change your thought process, God says, what did he say? He says, take heed to yourself and to the doctrine. To yourself and to the doctrine and continue in them. For in doing so, this will save both yourself and those who hears you. So when they doing all that stuff, you begin to say, you know what, man, y'all not to quit that. Y'all shouldn't be doing that no more. Man, who are you to talk to us like that? I'm just saying, man, you know, it's time for us to stop drinking. And we got to get back in church, you know, so that the Lord can bless us so we can do some things. When you start talking to young people about church, they turn a deaf ear to you most of the time because they ain't trying to get up in nobody's church and hear nobody tell them about the word. But tell them about that party. Boy, and tell them about Sister Chair going to be at the party. Tell them about Brother Table, he going to show up at the party. Oh, man, you can't get dressed fast enough because you're trying to get to the party. Well, tell them about Jesus. He going to be at the church today. Tell them about God. He going to show up. Man, they can't find nothing to put on. They can't find nothing to put on. I can't make it today. I can't find nothing to put on, man. You know, I'll try it next Sunday. Maybe I come up with something right then. They can't find nothing to put on. But you tell them Brother and Sister Chair is going to be there and Brother Table is going to show up at the party. They don't care how they look. They just got to get there because they know if they get there, what? The party is on. I can't do it like I used to, but the party is on. I want you to understand that when you get into the house of God, the party should still be on. If you was a flamboyant praiser to the songs out there, don't lose your drive. Bring that praise to the house of God. God, I thank you that the roof is on fire and it didn't fall on me. God, I thank you that you're going to bless me even the more because your problems, your circumstance, and your situations, they're in the roof. You know that thing about the roof. The roof is on fire. You don't need no water. But I tell you now that God will bless you because he said, look to the hill for which cometh my help. My help cometh from the Lord. He is the maker of heaven and earth. Look to that roof and watch God begin to pour you out blessings. You won't have room enough to receive. There's a power in you. There's a gift in you. There's a blessing in you. But Satan will send his imps to stop you from being successful. So it doesn't matter your age. You're still young in heart. Go do what God told you to do. He will bless you. Hebrews 6 and 14 says, saying, surely bless you, I will bless you. And multiplying you, I will multiply you. Say it again, Pastor, in closing. Jesus tells us, he tells us in Hebrews 6 and 14. He says, saying, surely bless you, I will bless you. And multiplying you, I will multiply you. God is ready to multiply us, saints. He's ready to give us our heart desire. He's ready for us to be fully read and doing the things which he said that he'd bless us with and bless us for. So we give God the praise, we give God the honor, and we give him everything that we know in our hearts. And when you begin to just give it to God, you just want to give it to God. When you wake up, you just be in so much remorse. God, I thank you that I was on the wake-up list this morning, and you allowed me to wake up, God. So now today, God, this is the day you've made. Allow me to rejoice and be glad in it. And then, saints, watch this. As you begin to talk to God about your innermost thoughts, your innermost feelings, and your spirit begins to yearn to the power of God, tears are going to begin to come out of your eyes because your spirit is humbling. But the Bible tells us that Jesus is bottling up every tear. Every tear that comes down your face, he's bottling it up. Because he said, I know the hairs on your head. I know how many you have. So he said, I take personal what you're going through. And so as you begin to raise your hands and you begin to cry out to God and you're so hurt and things is coming against you that's so strong and so horrendous that you don't know which way to go. You don't know who to talk to no more because who you talk to gave you up and who you talk to didn't satisfy what you're going through. But God, here I am. Help me get through this thing that's coming against me. And the tears begin to come out of your eyes because you feel that thing in your heart. You feel it in your beings. You feel everything about it. And you're crying out to God saying, God, I need help. And God says, come to me all this burden and heavy laden. Take my yoke and learn of me. For my yoke is easy and my burden is light. You heard that being preached. But right now, you just need to hear from God. And you stay right there. He said, be ye steadfast, unmovable, always abounding in the word of the Lord. So you're steadfast. You're not going nowhere because this situation is so hard. This situation is so horrendous that it's got you heavy. And you know what has been sent to you, if it was successful, it's going to take you out. And so you already know, I can't do this. I can't live like this no more, Father. Help me get through this situation. He says in Hebrews 10 and 35, he says, don't you lose your confidence in me. It's going to bring great reward and encompassing. And so great reward and recompense. And so with that recompense, you're still looking up at God. You're saying, God, I trust you. God, I trust you. He said in Mark 9, the ninth chapter, says, Lord, I believe, but help me with my unbeliefs. Because when you begin to unbelieve, when you think that God is not going to bless you, when you think that God is not going to work it out for you, when you think that your God has let you down, Satan will begin to send in his imp. Whew, go get her, because she's on the fence now. Go get him, because he's on the fence now. He don't believe in God now like he did 2 weeks ago, because what's coming against him now is going to break him down. Go get him. Go get him quickly. Go get him. And so the whole day you thought about, man, I can't even talk to people no more because, you know, my throat is just not like it used to be. There's heaviness about me. I don't feel like talking. Are you tired? Nah, man, I ain't tired. I just don't feel like it. Are you tired, my sister? No, I just don't feel like talking today because there's so much going on inside of you. Your heart is hurting. My brother, let's talk about it. Nah, man, I don't even feel like talking about it, man. Ain't going to do no good. I've been talking about it, but ain't nothing going to work for me. Oh, yeah, Satan, like, yeah, keep going at him. Keep going at him. And them demons are hitting you right on the lip. Bam. And they say, oh, man, you know what, man? I don't know what it is, man, but I keep getting this pain in my leg. I don't know where it come from. I ain't did nothing different, but I keep getting a pain in my leg. What in the world going on? Let me strengthen that. But you still feel hurt. You still feel broken down. Bam, there's a pain in your stomach. You don't know where it came from. So now your leg hurting in your stomach. You're like, man, what in the world is happening to me? Because Satan knows I got you on the fence. And if I can get you on the fence, I can put things against your body that you're not focused on. I'll put that against your body. You'll focus on it more so than focusing on the power of God. I know I ain't talking to nobody here this morning, but I do want you to understand that God knows what you're going through. He sees what you're going through, but Satan sees it as well. He knows what you're going through as well. But you're putting a loan at the bank, and if, man, if I can just get this loan, it's going to be a game changer for me, game changer for my family. And you just praying, you just seeking the Lord. You're praying and seeking the Lord. They said they're going to notify you on Tuesday about whatever you're going to prove or disapprove. So you're praying all that weekend. You're thanking the Lord. You go to church and you say, this has happened. This has happened, Pastor. But pray for me because I know this loan is going to help me get through the situation. You go, thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Tuesday come by and you call them people and say, nah, we're not going to approve you. Oh, Lord, you mean I'm doing all that for no reason. My God, I've been praising God till I was hurting. I don't even feel like reading the Bible no more, so you don't read it. I don't feel like talking about the Lord because people was calling you and they was talking to you. You gave them good advice about the Lord. Why? Because you feel like I got to keep my mind straight. I got to keep my mind clear. I got to keep looking because I know God going to bless me with this loan. But he didn't bless you with that loan. Huh, what do I do now? My God, what's going on with me? The door is open, but there are many adversaries. God did not bless you with that loan because he knows that down the road, some things was going to happen that you wouldn't be able to pay it back or keep it. See, when God blesses you, no man will be able to pluck it out of his hand. So God didn't want you to go through that institute because he knows how crooked that institute is. He knows that what should have given you 5%, that institute is going to charge you 12%. So you didn't know it because who really reads the fine line? Nobody but me. Okay, do you really read the fine line when they say sign right here? Do you really say, hold up, I can't sign that unless I read the fine print? Well, don't worry about it. It says this, it. No, I got to read the fine print. Well, if you don't have time for me to read, then I really don't have time to get this loan with you. Okay, well, go and read it then, because you'll find out that after the 90th day, what they gave you at 4%, after that 90th day, they're going to turn that thing all the way to 28%. My God, you wouldn't expect that. Now you're mad. Now you're frustrated. And now you're trying to figure out how the world I get myself into this. But see, that's why Jesus said, I disapproved that loan, because you didn't read the fine print. We're angry at God, but he protected us. So what am I saying to you? He says, In all things, pray to God. You just was on Instagram, and they said you can get this loan. And you thought, okay, man, I'm just going to apply for it. I think I can get it. You just on Instagram. You didn't go to God. You went to Instagram. God said, I want to bless you. God said, I want to give you a heart desire. But if you persevere in your responsibilities towards God, God will persevere towards his responsibilities towards you. Say it one more time in closing. If you persevere in your responsibility towards God, God will persevere towards his responsibilities towards us. He said in Hebrews 6 and 18, he says, I swore on two immutable things. It's impossible for me to lie. So he can't lie. He said, heaven and earth will pass away before this word does. Then he said, I took an oath on two things that I cannot lie to you. So if I can't lie, I can't lie. If I said I'm going to bless you, I will. If I said I'm going to heal you, I shall. If I said you're going to work it out, it's going to get worked. Everything is going to be okay. It will. We got to be steadfast, saints, unmovable, and know that you have an adversary out there that does not want to see you progress. They won't see you progress. And so if you stand fast and you persevere in your responsibility towards God, God will help you. And I am looking for God to do some magnificent things in this house. I want you to understand we are still in the season to receive the major harvest. We are still in the season to receive the major harvest. I know I went away from it this month, but he sent me here to say just encourage him and let him know that everything is going to be all right. And so I've been encouraging to let you know that God says there is a harvest. He said the harvest is plentiful, but the labors are few. So he told me to encourage you so that you would not be part of the fall part, but you'll be part of the receive part. In the mighty name of Jesus. Don't you quit here. There's a gift in you. There's a drive in you. There's a talent in you. But most of all, there's God in you that want to give you more than you've ever had in your life. It does not matter your age. It matters your diligence. And if you're going to give your all to God, and if you do it, he'll give his all to you. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. 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 Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you, Lord. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Persevering in your responsibility in the name of Jesus. All right. All right. All right. Let's do a prayer. If you can stand, if you would, please. And if you want to sit, you can sit. But I want to pray, because I want us to realize that the God we serve is not, he's not playing with us, saints. he's not a God that'll play with you. He said, this will change and it will. He said, I do this, he will. He said, I work it out, he will. So we serve a God that he don't play with you. He just do what he says, that's it. Heavenly Father, I come to you. I thank you for what you've done in this atmosphere. God, help us to persevere in our responsibility towards you, that we can do all things and receive all things from you. God, whatever your people is going through today, I want you to begin to reach out to them and bless them. God, you know where their heart is. You know what's coming against them. You know what's been trying to pull them in a direction of you, not of you. So, God, I surrender it all, God. They surrender it all. So, God, bring us back into your fold that we're able to receive the goodness and the positives of you. So, God, as I preach that Logos word, I want you to send in a rhema word to your people in the mighty name of Jesus, that they're able to hear, God, and fully understand. And as they leave here, God, don't let nothing or nobody take the word from them that they said is hiding in their hearts, and they're going to stand on that word. So let no one or no circumstance or no situation begin to take that word from your people. So today we're going to progress. Today we're going to move forward. Today we're going to receive the goodness of you, God. Today you're going to change our situation. Today you're going to help our family members, God. Today everyone that's connected to us, God, that when we pray, you're going to be right there for them. Why? Because we ask you to do it, God. And because we ask you to do it, you said that you're going to open up the windows of heaven and pours out blessings. We don't have room enough to receive. So because of it, God, I'm asking you now to bless your people. Bless us, God, like never before. Give us the strength like never before. Give us the joy like never before. In the mighty name of Jesus. Because we want to persevere in the responsibilities towards becoming the best us that we can possibly be. So thank you now, God, for what you've done. How you going to continue to bless us? God, there's a freedom about you. And we want to receive that freedom today. There's a freedom about you. In the name of God, there's a freedom about you. And I want you, God, to bless us with that freedom and that joy and that strength beyond measure. take away anything, God, that's not of you, that's contradicting you. God, take it away now from the ears of your people. Take it away now, God, that they're able to hear from you and begin to bless them like never before. God, bless them so good and not the shoes are, because that's how powerful you are. In the mighty name of Jesus, God, I'm strengthened today. I'm better now, God, that I heard your word. Things is going to work out for me, and I give you the praise. I give you the honor, and I give you the glory. All because you're God, and I know you can do it. So God, because you blessed me yesterday, because you blessed me last month, because you blessed me last year, what's coming against me now, God, I know you got this too. So I'm standing in awe of you today, God. I'm standing in awe of you today, God. Let your will be done. Let your power flow. Let it do now, Father. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. And amen. Flow to you. Happy Father's Day to my fathers. And then celebrating the Juneteenth for Youth Sunday. Thank you, thank you, thank you for our youth. We're going to move now towards tithing. Tithing, tithing, tithing. I always want to read this to you. All because some people think that tithing is of the Old Testament, and they don't think that they should be tithing. So they don't. But I want to read this to you from the New Testament, 2 Corinthians, and chapter 9 tells us, "But I say this to you, he who sows sparingly will also reap sparingly. He who sows bountifully will also reap bountifully. So let each one give as he purposes in his heart, not grudgingly nor of necessity. For God loves a cheerful giver. And the God is able to make all grace abound towards you, that you, always having all sufficiencies in all things, may have an abundance for every good works." So God is looking at your works. He's looking at your every good works. I know these well-known pastors, they begin to say, you know, you shouldn't pay your tithes. You shouldn't bring no type of offering to the church, that God will provide for the church. But you're not doing it. You're not doing it for personal gain, because you're just grudgingly doing it. But you're doing it for, let me back that up, you are doing it for personal gain. You want God to bless you personally. And so doing, when you do the power of God and you do the will of God, he not only will bless your finances, he said, "I'll bless your household." So I wish above all that you prosper and be in good health, even as our soul shall prosper. Sometimes, saints, we have to give through tithes and offering out of your situations, your circumstances. So whatever the Lord is placing upon your heart, in this house, we don't have a $20 line. We don't have a $50 line. We're not going to stand in front of this thing and count and say, "Well, man, we short $200. Can anybody else bring?" No, we don't do that either. We ask you to give what God has told you to give as laid upon your heart. If he told you to give 50 cents, then do what he's told you to do. And I want you to understand that the God is going to bless you. He's going to work it out. That's between you and God. And so when you do that and you give it in faith, God says, "I'm going to bless you mightily." So as we begin to pass the basket around, I want you to feel free to let God bless you like I know he can, and he will. Thank you, my sister. Thank you, thank you, thank you. All right, all right, all right. In the name of Jesus. Whew, what an awesome God we serve. He will bless us mightily. I want you to understand that God does hear your prayers. God is going to bless you. A man's stomach shall be satisfied from the fruit of his mouth, and from the produce of his lips he shall be filled. Death and life are in the power of the tongue, and those who love it will eat its fruits. So that's in the book of Proverbs chapter 18, verses 20 and 21. He who has pity on the poor lends to the Lord, and he will pay back what he's given. Proverbs 19, verse 17. So God wants to bless us, brothers and sisters. God wants to move us in a different direction. So in your finances, give to God. You know, I'm not above my tithes either. I got a job, so I have to bring my tithes as well. And so I just thank God. Thank God. Because it seems like I can't make it without paying tithes. I can't make it. I just don't know how some people do it. They say, I ain't bringing no tithes in there. Well, if your tithes is $10 and you give $2, I don't understand. I just know I love the Lord. If your tithes is $10 and you give $2 and you say, Lord, I'm just going to give you $2 so they leave me alone, and I just put something in the basket so they'll leave me alone. Well, it's not about that. It should be about you and God. If God say, pay, bring your $10 and bring it, and know that he's going to bless you. We cannot obligate God unless we do his word. When you do his word and you do his will, let me have it. Okay. When you do his word and you do his will, we have then obligated God. So now, if you want to give from the internet, you would go to PushPay and text 77977, and your message queue, you would put in EH Give. And this way, it sends you to a link, and then you can give as often or however you want to flow. You can do it like that. And then you say, Pastor, give me another way. So Cash App, $3177, and in your subject, you tell me how you want that money to flow, and I'll get it there. I'm telling you, some people are really doing Cash App, and it seems like their income is increasing. It's increasing. It's increasing. I pray, I say, Lord, thank you for the increase, because they are doing what God has told them to do, and I'm seeing the evidence of it. So thank you, God. Thank you, God. Thank you, God. I keep saying that I have some millionaires in this house. I keep proclaiming that I have millionaires in this house. Thank you, thank you, thank you. And it's not that I'm worrying about the money. It's worrying about the obedience, that I have millionaires in this house. And you may be one. I don't know what your finances is, but if you are one, just let God continue to lead you. But I'm telling you, I keep believing that I'm sitting or standing now among millionaires, because they're doing the right thing by God. God is going to bless you. All right, so we got the people that's online. We're standing here now. Heavenly Father, I come to you. I thank you, God. That online input is coupled in this basket. So, God, I thank you that your word shall not go out void, but do what it was purposed to do. Your word says you're going to bless us. Your word says you're going to help us. Your word says you're going to strengthen us. So let this basket not be something of collections that you're not proud of. In the mighty name of Jesus. And God, some want to give more. So strengthen them, God, and help them, and take them down the avenue where they can find more to give, be able to be more of a blessing to you. Some have a heart, Lord God, and they just want to drop payloads into this basket. But God, you know their heart. And because of it, God, I'm asking you to strengthen them. Give them more purchase power, that they're able to receive more, God. Move, God, them into a direction that they're trying to open up a business. Give them the avenue to go down, Lord God, that they will be able to receive the necessary finances, God, to finance their objective, in the mighty name of Jesus. So, God, we've done what you say to do. We came and we gave just like you said to do. So now we're waiting on you, God, to stand on your word. And I believe that you will. Stand on your word now, God. Stand on your word. This do now, Father. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen, amen, and amen. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. All right, before we get to the last phase, Elder Beatty, you have a prayer list. You ready? Okay. We're going to pray over the people on that prayer list, and then we're going to move towards testimonies. If you have a testimony, we'll ask you at that time. If you want to say it, you can say it, and if we're not going to put you on the spot. If you want to testify, that's up to you. But you got the opportunity now to kind of get your mind ready to receive. Yes, ma'am. Go ahead. It's on you. Yeah.
Lord, you know each one by name, God. I just ask you, Lord, to touch this situation, Father. For Lord, you are Jehovah Rapha, Lord, the God of healing, Father. So I ask you, Lord, to touch your people right now, Lord, concerning their situation, Lord. Remember Brother Zeno and his family, God. Bless and strengthen them during this time, Lord. I ask you to bless and strengthen Sister Terrence, Lord, during this time, Father. Let your will be done in our life, Father. Bless and strengthen Sister Sheila and Brother Odell, Lord. Bless and strengthen my brother Roy and Mike, Lord. His wife, Dorothy, Lord. Willie and Stella, Lord. Bless and strengthen Brother Ollie Jr., Lord. Father, I just ask you, Lord, to touch Sister Ashley, Lord. Father, touch Sister Kaylin Smith and her family, Lord. Sister Talicia Smith, Lord, as she's away from the family, God. Bless and protect her, Lord, and continue, Lord, to lead and guide them, Father. Lord, Sister Isabel Carr, Lord, I ask, Lord, for strength for her on today, Father. Bless and strengthen that mother, Lord. Father, I just ask you, Lord, to remember Sister Shelby, Lord, a mother, Lord, dealing with health issues, God. I just ask you to touch her now, God, in the name of Jesus, Lord. Lord, I just ask you, Lord, to remember each and every one, Lord. Lord, the people are depending on you, Lord, your people, God, looking to you for their help, God. Remember Sister Kimberly, Lord. Bless and strengthen her on today, Lord. Remember Sister Kathleen and her family, Lord. Bless and strengthen them on today, Father. Thank you, Lord, for the house, God, for your people, Lord, that have come to hear your word, God, to feast on your word, God. Give them strength, Lord. Lord, I just ask that you touch your people, God. Every private thought that they have, God, the Lord, that concern, God, ask you, Lord, to meet their need, Lord, in the name of Jesus, God. Bless like only you can, Father. Do it for your glory, God. In Jesus' name we pray, Lord. Amen.
All right. All right. Before we close, does anyone have a testimony they want to say something to the congregation about? Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Yes. Thank you. Yes, ma'am. Thank you. Wow. Yes. Yeah. Oh, thank you, Lord. Hallelujah. Yeah, there you go. Yeah. That's right.
See, I'm mostly obligated God right. to do anything, but it's rejoicing to my soul when God just show you things.
That's right.
So, y'all keep us in prayer.
Yeah.
I'm going to do the same for y'all, but
thank you.
Your prayer works.
Thank you. Thank you for that testimony. Yeah, that helps us all out, because we're not going to quit, cave in, or give up. Is there anyone else? Anyone else? Yes. What's she saying? What's she saying? I can't hear her.
Say it again. I thank God for every single good, every single people.
Out of the mouth of babes and sucklings have I ordained praise. So thank you, thank you, thank you. Anyone else before we close?
I do want to say, I'm so sorry. Forgive me, Pastor. I just want to say that I'm here, y'all. I told y'all I was going to be here with y'all to have help. I'm going to start to be on Wednesday.
That's right.
And
get uh-huh. Oh, thank you, Lord. Woo! That's what I'm talking about. Yes, Lord. Yeah. 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 Absolutely. Yeah. Wow. That's what I'm talking about. He's a healer. He's a healer. Yeah. Anyone else before we close? All right, if you would stand. Okay, go ahead. Yes, ma'am. What you say? What you say? Well, thank you, thank you, thank you. Truly appreciate it. Pound cake, y'all. Happy Lucy. Yeah. Thank you, thank you, thank you. Thank you, thank you, thank you. Hallelujah. Anyone else before we close? about the goodness of God and what he's done in your life. Hallelujah. If you would please stand, we would close. We would close. Listen, I want you to still follow me on Bible study. God is opening up doors for us. He's still seeing some things. There you go, buddy. Father, in the name of Jesus, I thank you for who you are, for what you've done. God, I thank you for blessing us and keeping us covered under your blood. What a powerful God you are. You're a strong tower. God, thank you for getting rid of all cancer in Kathleen's body, Father, that it shall not flow and is gone forever, never to return. So I thank you now, Lord God, for how you blessed that young lady. Now, Lord God, and everyone that's in jail that's listening to me now, touch their heart, touch their mind, God, and let them understand that it's not too late. If they're still breathing, Lord God, you can save them right where they are. Those that's in the hospital that's listening to me, God, begin to strengthen them and help them, God, to begin to plead the blood of Jesus over their situation, and everything will begin to turn out just right. Because you said that we could use that blood in time of tribulations, according to Romans 9 and 5. And so because of it, God, we're standing on your word that we're cleansed. We are cleansed and we're created by you in the name of Jesus. So, Father, as we leave here, bind all mechanical failure, let no hurt, harm, or danger come to us, but keep us covered under your blood. Now, Lord, let us have a great day today. Let us come together as family and begin to enjoy one and the other. Now, Lord, let the words of my mouth and the meditation of my heart be acceptable in thy sight. O Lord, my strength and my redeemer. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen, and go in peace.